वर्मा,
ओके सर, स्टार्ट।
सो आई फॉर्मली इनवाइट डॉक्टर राजीन वर्मा टू टेक द डायस एंड बिगिन द प्रोसीडिंग्स ऑफ दिस सैटरडे सेमिनार।
ओके, थैंक यू सर। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल राइट रिक्वेस्ट, प्लीज और योरसेल्फ ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स प्लीज टेक योरसेल्फ। Good morning to all. Today we are pleased to welcome Professor Paneer Selvam sir, very specialist guest, very special guest from academic world. Sir, on behalf of myself and our department, we are deeply appreciative and offer you our most grateful welcome. Really, we are deeply honored to welcome you, sir. Professor Paneer Selvam sir is a senior faculty and former head Department of Philosophy, University of Madras, and General Secretary of IPC and member of governing body ICPR. Sir is a great scholar of postmodernism. Sir published many books and papers, all of which are not possible to mention here due to shortage of time. Sir, I am sure today lecture is going to be very interesting, thought provoking, and also beneficial for all of us. Thank you, sir. And dear all students, today lecture is very beneficial all of you, so please listen carefully. Now I formally invite our head professor Kesi Pande sir to welcome Professor Paneer Selvam sir. Please, Professor Kesi Pande sir.
Yes, very good morning to all of philosophers here. I formally welcome first of all our speaker, Professor Paneer Selvam, personally, and I have been very close to him for decades and decades. So sir, vanakkam, namaskar, very good morning.
Vanakkam.
That you are
vanakkam,
here, sir. It's your ashirvadam, sir, that you are here. And we are recording this and we'll put in YouTube also. So everything is very pleasant today morning. I welcome everybody here, and I welcome all the participants here of today this Saturday seminar. I welcome Professor D.N. Yadav, Pro Vice Chancellor of Nilambar Pitambar University, Jharkhand, and Dr. Murli. Dr. Murli is available here. I'm very happy to see him after a long, long time. Dr. Murli, you're such a wonderful person. Organized such a wonderful IPC,
thank you,
sir. I was there in the IPC, your IPC, so it's very pleasant to see you here. And your work on Amartya Sen is such a wonderful to see you here. And then I'm very happy to see so many scholars. Dr. Alok Tandon is here, so this makes a little hot this seminar, because he asked so many wonderful questions and then good discussion. Thank you, sir, Dr. Alok Tandon, that you are here. Then Dr. Kosi is here, my friend. Kosi, I'm very happy to see Kosi.
Thank you,
here.
Thank you.
And
thanks.
It's wonderful that so many persons from across India, Dr. Bharat Patel, and then I can see.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Many persons like available here, Dr. Pitambar Das, then from east to west, south to north. Then Purvayan is here. Then, I mean, it's difficult to take the names of everybody here. But this is such a pleasant. Sariam Abbas is here. And it's very pleasant to see names here and get interactions with a scholar. It's a very rare moment that sir has accepted our invitation. So I formally welcome everybody here. I say it's difficult to take everybody's name here because some names are not visible also, but more than 70 persons have now participated by this moment, and people are increasing only. So I hope that it will be a wonderful talk, and we all will enjoy today and then afterwards also, because this will be available in the recorded form. All the lecture and interactions will be available in the recorded form. So I request that please do not push the button present now, because that will take you out of the this thing, the screen. So everybody is most welcome in this pleasant video, and I will just start the screen sharing also.
Let's start.
I will do screen sharing, sir. Please start.
Okay. Yeah. My good friend, Professor K.C. Pandey, and other friend who are available. And my research scholars who are available. I am grateful to all of you. For your kind presence. I am little afraid, I will say, because there are various scholars who are well versed in this topic, like Professor Murli and Kushi and others. But let me make an attempt to present to explain the concept of communicative action in the background of Indian philosophical tradition. Now the purpose of my lecture is mainly to discuss how Habermasian theory of communicative action in the context of Indian philosophical tradition, especially Indian philosophy of language. Professor K.C. Pandey, there is some echo.
Just
hello.
Yes, sir. Hello? Just a moment, sir. Yes, sir. Just a moment. Now please see, sir. Now.
Is it okay? Now?
Yeah. Now it's okay, sir.
You can mute all the mics.
Because there is an echo.
He has to mute all the mics.
Yeah, please mute all the mics, sir. I'm muting everyone.
Okay.
Skip the speaker.
Now let me go further. So the purpose of my paper or presentation is to discuss the theory of communicative action in the context of Indian philosophy of language. Of course, I am not making a comparative study, because I know the limitations of comparative study. But I am trying to draw certain parallels between the theory of communicative action from Habermasian side and the dialogue between Mimamsakas and the Advaitin. So this parallel really shows how philosophers, though emerge from different philosophical tradition and culture, can have some affiliation. In fact, I would like to quote B.K. Mathilal, who says that it is philosophically important to ponder over the questions why similar puzzles produce different answers. Problems are one and the same, but we get different answers for the same problem because of the cultural or historical differences. So what is significant in the communicative action of Habermas is that he talks about what is known as discourse. It becomes an action involving the speaker. So that's why he defines his theory as a communicative action. Communication is an action. In Indian philosophical tradition, one can see the role of Shabda, for example, because in Shabda also we talk about the statement of a trustworthy person, and we accept the statement of a trustworthy person as something which is very important. The communicative action is very much visible in the dialectic of Mimamsakas, especially the Prabhakaras and the Advaitins. So I am making an humble attempt to show how this could be viewed from Indian perspective.
Should I
present this now, is a simple attempt, of course,
should I present now PPT?
Now you can go to the first one. Yeah, I'll tell you. Now we'll go to the slide.
Okay, sir.
First one.
Okay.
First
sir.
One, please.
Okay, sir.
First one.
Okay.
Yeah. Next one. Now these are second one. Please go to the second one.
Okay, sir.
These are some of the important major works of Habermas. Born in the year 1929, now he's 90 years old, and he has been gone writing on various fields. He writes on sociology, he writes on philosophy, he writes on religion. So his interest is diversified, and it is very difficult to locate him at a particular space, because when you are trying to locate him at a particular space, then he moves from there to another space. So this is one difficulty. These are some of the important major works. The Structural Transformation of Public Sphere, Theory and Practice, On the Logic of Social Sciences, Knowledge and Human Interest, Legitimation Crisis, The Theory of Communicative Action, Volume 1 and 2. Then the Philosophical Discourse on Modernity, Between Facts and Norms, and the Divided West. These are some of the works. Of course, there are many, but I would be concentrating on two works. One is, I would consider this as a magnum opus of Habermas, that is Knowledge and Human Interest. And the second book, which I would be considering, is The Theory of Communicative Action. And then I'll try to apply this in the Indian context. Now, the plan of my lecture, please go to the third slide, please. I am going to discuss this topic in seven heads. Please, Kesi Pandey, please go to the third slide.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Third slide.
Can you see the slide, sir?
Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello? Do you hear me?
Yes, sir. I can hear you. Please tell me which slide you want.
I want the second one.
Okay. About what?
Second one. Yeah. About the major works of Habermas.
Okay.
And then we can go on. Okay.
Please wait, sir. Please wait. This one, sir?
Second one. Second one.
Yeah, this and this second, sir. This is second, sir?
This is second. Next. Go to the next one.
This one, three kinds of human interest.
No. Before that.
This one.
No.
And this one, sir.
Pandeji is not coming. Slides are not coming.
Yeah, slides are coming, sir. In the book, sir. This is the one. No. This is the one.
No, I'm not making the slides. I'm not.
Slide is not coming in the skin, Pandeji.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. Wait. Now, please see. Is it visible?
It's now coming. Yes.
Yeah, before that, before this.
Okay. Before this, is this
Yeah, this one. Yeah, this is my plan of my lecture.
Okay.
I got the 7 important subtopics which I would like to discuss with you. Theory, 3 kinds of human interests, the ideal speech situation, communicative rationality, reconstructing reason through communicative action. Then 5th, 6th and 7th are from Indian standpoint, language and reality in Indian philosophical language, sabda as a source of knowledge, then communicative action, the dialectic of Mimamsakas and Advaitis. In the previous slide, you can see Habermas keeping my book with him. This is a very important slide I thought I should share with you because it was a very important moment for me when I met Habermas in the year 2000 in Frankfurt University. In fact, he invited me for a seminar wherein I had ample time to discuss with some of the important contributions of Habermas, like the ideal speech situation and all. So at the time, I presented a copy of my book, that is The Problem of Meaning and in Wittgenstein and Chakra, where I made a study of Habermas also. He was interested to read that. Of course, he said he would read it. Of course, it's very difficult to get a reply from such a great eminent personalities. Now, so 7 topics, then we'll go to the next slide, please. 3 kinds of human interests. Please go to the third one. Yeah. 3 kinds of human interests. As I said in the beginning, that I would consider this knowledge and human interest, the book written by Habermas, is the magnum opus because it very beautifully structures 3 kinds of human interest. In fact, he says that there is what is called a radical critique of knowledge. He makes this statement, there is a radical critique of knowledge. And further, he says that radical critique of knowledge is possible as a social theory. What does this mean? That is, he is talking about not epistemology, but a metacritic of epistemology. Because all of us know that epistemology underwent a radical review in the hands of Kant. But what is interesting is that epistemology itself can be a question, because there are some fundamental mistakes on which epistemology is constructed. For example, Wittgenstein would show that the traditional epistemology is based on certain fundamental mistakes. And Richard Rorty also talks about that. So it is very essential to talk about the metacritic of epistemology. That is, otherwise, one can make a distinction between epistemology on the one side and the critique of epistemology. So the critique of epistemology is what Habermas is talking about in knowledge and human interest. So he talks about there exists an inseparable relation between knowledge and human interest. And his aim is to develop a language which is based on, which is the basis for communicative understanding. And through communicative understanding, he says social understanding is possible. Please note, his main purpose is to establish or to prove how social understanding is possible. And the knowledge, he says, comes to us through social interaction, or what we call intersubjectivity. So it is through a dialogue, according to Habermas, that we can understand each other. But he says most of the time, the dialogue is not taking place. On the other hand, what is taking place is only a monologue. And the best example is the classroom teaching, where teacher all the time speaks and there is no space for the students. So it is through the medium of language we can understand the social group, and we can understand the entire world. So it is through interaction which is the basis for communicative understanding. And here it talks about 3 important kinds of knowledge or types of knowledge: the empirical hyphen analytical interest, otherwise known as instrumental interest. Then second is the hermeneutic hyphen historical interest, otherwise known as practical interest. And the third is a critical hyphen emancipatory interest. This is the most important one. the emancipatory interest. So knowledge, now what he is trying to say is knowledge is not identified by one single interest. And in fact, this is what the positivists claim, that is, they are of the view, they were of the view that knowledge is always identified with a single interest. But Habermas tries to show that there are plenty of interests, or what is called the plurality of interests. And he further says, whether one is conscious or not, these three types of interests are operating in us. Now let us discuss these three types of interests. We'll go to the next slide, please. In the empirical, that is the first one, in the empirical or analytical interest, the validity depends on what is known as technical exploitability. What does this mean? This means the technical exploitability is rooted in a desire for technical control. And the main problem here, according to Habermas, he says that the first problem one faces with this kind of interest is there is what is called narrow scientism, and there is also called naive objectivism. So in this instrumental interest, language is monologic. So communicative action cannot be reduced to this type of understanding. Because communicative action, according to him, is a dialogue, and it has a system of reference. And in a dialogue, the framework of a symbolic interaction is essential. So for these reasons, he rejects the first one, namely the empirical analytical interest. Then he moves towards the second one, the hermeneutical or historical interest. That is, all interpretative or humanistic approach is guided by this. And in fact, Habermas gives a special importance to this, no doubt. He says it is an improvement over the first one. In fact, he says this practical interest supports the communicative action. And it is not only hermeneutical in nature, but also historical. This is what he specifies with regard to this. It is also historical because meanings that come to constitute the societies are not an outcome of the development of historical tradition. But there is also advantage, no doubt, because as I said, it is an advancement over the first one. But at the same time, it says that it cannot exhaustively define the social phenomena. So what he is trying to say is, though the first one is second one is better than the first, there are certain difficulties. Now with regard to the first one, he says that there is no critical approach, and with regard to the second one, there is a pre-understanding of a traditional heritage. This is a criticism that is leveled against the second one. So he thinks that there is a need for moving towards what is known as the emancipatory interest, otherwise known as the critical interest, which points towards an ideal space for free communication, unmasking the hidden systematic distortion. Habermas is of the view that there is always a distorting communication. So one should have a free communication. So he says the third one is a special case of the second one, of course. It is an improvement, but the difference is that it is not a mere description of this. So it is not intended to criticize or transform them. This means that the values and norms have social functions. What Habermas is trying to say here is that in this third kind of interest, Professor K.C. Pandey, am I audible?
Yeah, very much, sir.
Am I audible?
Yeah, very much.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. So what is important is, in the third one, there is a shift. What is that shift? We move from what is to what ought to be. So this is not a monotic analysis, but it is a dialogue where the authentic discussion takes place between the speaker and the hearer. In other words, he says that here there is a symmetrical relation. This is a very beautiful relation which speaks of a symmetrical relation. A symmetrical relation is one where the speaker and the hearer are equal, because most of the time we don't have this symmetrical relation. We have only asymmetrical relation where there is no equality between the speaker and the hearer. So what he is aiming at is to develop a discourse wherein both the speaker and the hearer would participate. And in fact, this I would say is the most important contribution of not only Habermas but many of the hermeneutical thinkers. Because normally when we read a text, it is said that we have to take the meaning which is implicit in the text. But in the discourse which is developed in the contemporary hermeneutics, it is said that it is necessary for the hearer or the listener to ask for his role, which means there should be a dialogue while discussing a particular text. It is not a one-side relation, but it is a dual relation wherein the speaker and the hearer participate. Now, in this context, I would like to state that Habermas is of the view that Gadamer, who is a well-known hermeneutician, he says through Gadamer, language acquires a third dimension. And he says this is a very important development in the philosophy of language. I repeat that through Gadamer, language acquired the third dimension. Now, what are the other two dimensions? The first dimension, he said, is very much available in the writings of Wittgenstein's Tractatus, because he could show that our ordinary language is not perfect. So it is our duty to develop an ideal language. So this, he says, is the first dimension of language. Then the second dimension of language, according to Habermas, is provided by Wittgenstein himself. That is, in the philosophical investigation, he could successfully show that our ordinary language is all perfect. So these are the two dimensions, but he says these two dimensions are not enough. There is a third dimension which was explicitly mentioned by Gadamer. So the very important contribution made by Gadamer with regard to language, especially philosophy of language, is this third dimension. That is, what does this mean? Gadamer has transcended, this is the words of Habermas. He says, Gadamer has transcended the monodic isolation of the language game of Wittgenstein. So this means interpretation is very much needed. In fact, I quote here Habermas. Habermas says, the unity of language, which disappeared in the pluralism of language game, is dialectically restored in the context of tradition by Gadamer. This is a very beautiful quotation Habermas with regard to Gadamer. Of course, he criticizes him also. I'll come to that. In the writings of Gadamer, we see the third dimension, but he says, Habermas says, this has been neglected by Wittgenstein, and he says language is only has handed down. But at the same time, Habermas attacks Gadamer's approach, which converts the historical insights into absolutization of a cultural tradition. So the major criticism is this against Gadamer. He says Gadamer overlooks the fact that language itself is dependent upon social process. And further, Habermas says language is also, this is very important, also is important, language is also a medium of domination and social power. So though he appreciates the third dimension of Gadamer, and he says this is very essential for philosophy of language, he says that there are certain problems with regard to the Gadamerian approach to language. But he says that the beautiful approach given by Gadamer cannot be neglected. Then there is also another important thing which you have to remember in the context of Habermas is that how he moves from what is called the philosophy of consciousness to communicative action. Shift, I would say, this is a shift from philosophy of consciousness to communicative action. By this, I mean that the philosophers have been talking about consciousness or mind. In fact, this made Richard Rorty to say that philosophers have been polishing the mirror of mind so that they can have the better vision of themselves. So all philosophers from the time of Plato onwards, they have been talking about either mind or consciousness. Now there is a shift. That is, after Wittgenstein, there is a shift because from philosophy of consciousness, we have moved towards a communicative action. But this communicative action Habermas, of course, is not something new. We find this, or we can say it has been shaped by J.L. Austin's performative act, then Searle's speech acts, but he moves further. That is, Habermas moves further to develop the communicative action in such a way that he calls it a dialogue between the speaker and the hearer. So communication is always an action that is taking place, and this is a remarkable contribution of Wittgenstein. Then I go to the second point. You can see the slide. That is ideal speech situation. This is a very beautiful concept. In fact, I had a very detailed discussion with Habermas on this. I have written something on this in Indian Philosophical Quarterly also long back. Now let me explain this. We can understand the concept of ideal language by first of all making the distinction between action and discourse. What do we mean by this? In any discourse, the speaker involved must have the reciprocity or reciprocality. There are four conditions that are involved in a discourse. This is very important. If possible, please see the slide. Now, the first one is the intelligibility of the utterance. The second one is the truth of the propositional content. And third is the correctness of the performatory component. And the fourth is the sincerity of the speaking subject. And I would like to concentrate on the fourth one, that is the sincerity of the speaking subject. In fact, if the speaker is sincere, in fact, I would like to apply this to Indian context, especially Shabda, wherein we say in Shabda, we believe the statement of a trustworthy person. Now, trustworthy person's statements we don't question because we believe that the person who is speaking or who is making the statement is sincere. Now, Habermas prescribes these four conditions which are essential for a dialogue. In all the four conditions, or if all the four conditions are satisfied, then communication is not only complete, but also unproblematic. This is a very important contribution of Habermas, because he says if these conditions are fulfilled, communication is not only complete, but is unproblematic. In fact, he says most of the time we have a problematic understanding. That is, we don't understand the other. So if, according to him, if we satisfy all the conditions while talking, then this problems that we face with regard to the statement which we hear can be easily transcended. Now, in one of his important books, Theory and Practice, he says, I would like to quote him, I quote, "The declarative claim to truth and the normative claim to correctness are claims of validity which can be proved only in discourse." Now, you see, in this statement, he tries to emphasize the significance of discourse through truth and normative claim. So this means only in discourse the meaningfulness of language is possible. In other words, only by proper usage of language in discourse we can understand the other. So in this is what we call the authentic discourse. It otherwise is known as unrestricted and universal communication. Unrestricted communication, that means your dialogue can go on, there is no restriction, provided there is a truth in the speaker's statement and the hearer also be in a position to understand the speaker. So that is what is called asymmetrical relation. Symmetrical relation is where there is equality between the speaker and the hearer. And in this, if we retain the symmetrical relation between the speaker and the hearer, then we can understand each other, not only each other, but we can understand the entire world. In fact, he says most of the problems arise because we don't understand the other. So he is prescribing a standard or a norm or a rule by which we can understand the other person. So the result of discourse, what is the use of this discourse? The use of discourse is decided by the better argument alone. So which means when we are having a dialogue with the other person, then we must be in a position to give better argument. Then only our dialogue can continue. So he calls this as a rational motivation. The rational motivation is very much essential in a discourse. In discourse, the argument is based on speech acts. It is based on speech acts. Ultimately, it is the speech acts which shapes the discourse. So the condition under which the force or better argument alone would prevail is made possible through the communicative competence. This is another beautiful phrase used by Habermas, that is communicative competence. Now, what do we mean by this communicative competence? It refers to the general conditions necessary for communication. And it also explains, in addition to this, it also explains the qualifications which the competent speaker must possess in order to have a meaningful dialogue. One might ask, what is the difference between this and the linguistic competence explained by Chomsky? Because Chomsky talks about the linguistic competence. Now, in the linguistic competence of Chomsky has been modified by Habermas by adding the theory of communicative competence. That is, in communicative competence, he transcends the empirical conditions of linguistic competence, which means that he has redefined the concept of linguistic competence of Chomsky. Now, we'll go to the next slide. Now, the next slide talks about reason. Now, in the post-metaphysical thinking, the role of reason is something very important. In fact, Richard Rorty considers reason as a social phenomenon. Casey Pandya, do you hear me? Is it okay?
Very much. Okay.
Because I sometimes have the doubt whether I am, audible. Okay. Now, in the post-metaphysical thing, because now we are talking about the communicative rationality. Now, let us see what reason or rationality, the role of rationality in Western tradition. And we shall see how Habermas has remodified the notion of reason. But in the post-metaphysical thinking, the role of reason is something important. The role of reason is important. Because Richard Rorty says it is a social phenomena, and Foucault also talks about disempowering the idea of reason. And similarly, Derrida also talks about the totalized critique of reason. So all philosophers in the contemporary period have been talking about the concept of reason. Now, Habermas also talks about reason in a different way. He reconstructed the Kantian notion of reason so as to explain the significance of the comprehensive reason, which is otherwise known as a communicative rationality. Now you see the difference. When other philosophers like Rorty, Foucault and Derrida have been talking about reason, Habermas has a different methodology to understand the concept of reason. He talks about what is called communicative rationality. And this is something very novel, because the rationality which he speaks is different from other thinkers, first of all. And the communicative rationality which he talks about involves the presupposition of communication. These presuppositions reveal a rational dimension of the communication. Please note, the important contribution of Habermas is how the rational dimension of a conversation play a major role in a discourse, which means the rational consensus is very much needed in order to have a proper understanding. Now, what constitutes the rational consensus? This is a very important concept. Now, what constitutes this rational consensus? And he says, free and equal discussion only constitutes the rational discourse or rational consensus. There should be a ground, this is very important, there should be a proper ground for our truth claim. Then I go to the third point in my slide, that is a communicative rationality. First, we have discussed that there are three kinds of interest in our slide. Then second point which I discussed is ideal speech situation. So from ideal speech situation, we move towards communicative rationality. Now, because first I created a background that how rationality has been discussed by other philosophers and why Habermas deviates from them. And now he develops the communicative rationality. Now, what does it mean by communicative rationality? It is the critique of, first of all, or the first presupposition that is involved in communicative rationality is that it is a critique of a scientific technological rationality. And in this way, it is different from other notions of rationality which philosophers have been contemplating on. So he is interested in constructing what is known as a social rationality. This is the difference. He wants to develop or frame something called a social rationality. This means the Western rationality has become a very important, it has played a very important role in Western philosophy, especially from the time of Descartes. But the charge that is leveled against this Western rationality, especially from the time of Descartes, according to Habermas, is that this Western rationality has led to domination. That's why he rejects. And also he quotes the dialectic of enlightenment, the well-known book which is written by Horkheimer and Adorno. And they say how reason, in fact, they very beautifully examine the role of reason. And both of them say that reason has turned into its opposite. This is their major criticism against rationality and results in domination. So the enlightenment reason has resulted in domination and regression. So Habermas wants to make a shift. Otherwise, we can say he wanted to revise the project of enlightenment rationality. So his idea was to offer an alternate to the subject-centered tradition of rationality. So against this background, Habermas defended the positivist aspects of enlightenment. He has not completely rejected that, but also he says how this could be, this should be modified. This should be modified. He wanted to emphasize the role of rationality in economics, in culture, and in morality. This is where he differs from other thinkers. And in his comprehensive concept of rationality, the values of the society, the norms of the society, and the interests of the common man are studied and they are presented. Now, what is the problem with regard to subject-centered reason? He says it is a product of division, as I said just now. And by communicative reason, he opens up the possibility of the social. That is, he wants all the social actors, that is, I mean, this means all human beings to participate. So his notion of communicative competence, his notion of communicative competence, which he calls the universal pragmatics. So the universal pragmatics has the argument, or it aims at systematically investigating the general structures. This is what the universal pragmatics was doing. Now, it is very important to know that how the subject centered reason is to be replaced by the communicative action. Now, what do you mean by this communicative action? In communicative action, the subject is a participant. That is, the participant, both the speaker and the hearer, participate in a dialogue, and they come to a common understanding, and then this dialogue goes on. So in communicative action, the subject is a participant, and there is a meaningful dialogue that is taking place between the speaker and the hearer. So this is nothing but a radical critique of reason. So this social rationality is achieved through what is known as undistorted communication. Then we come to the last point, that is fourth point with regard to Habermas, that is reconstructing rationalism through communicative action. I was fascinated by this book, Communicative Theory of Communicative Action, volume 1 and 2. In fact, I have written an extensive article nearly running into 40 pages with the title The Linguistification of the Sacred, wherein I argued that how Habermasian approach of communicative action is something marvelous which has emerged in the contemporary period. Now, his aim, what is the aim of these two volumes? His aim is not to reject reason, please note that. His aim is not to reject reason, but to construct reason, reconstruct reason. Reconstructing reason, and this is what he is doing in both the works. That is, in instrumental reason, there is domination. So there is no intersubjectivity that is involved. So he wants to develop a theory of communication wherein there is intersubjectivity, the role of the speaker and the hearer, and all the members of the society would participate in such a dialogue. So this means in the intersubjective communication, it is based on the social solidarity. Social solidarity is very much essential in order to understand the significance of the communicative action. Now, in this communicative action of Habermas, we see two beautiful concepts. One is with regard to the system. He talks about two concepts. One is a system, and the other is life world. Now, what is a system? A system is something which is rigid. You can't make any amendments or changes in that. That's why he calls it a system. But in the life world, you can make certain changes, or you can make certain modification so that it can be updated. Let me give one example from Indian side. We talk about theory of karma. No doubt it's a very very powerful concept in Indian philosophical tradition. Achha. But when we are talking about social justice in the 20th century, wherein we say that each and every individual should get his due, then we are trying to redefine the concept of karma, which means there is a need for reinterpreting some of the concepts which are available to us. This can be extended to Western philosophy also. There are certain concepts which have to be redefined or remodified. And in fact, Professor J.M. Mohanty says that if there are certain concepts which are not useful in philosophy, don't hesitate, simply reject it. So there is no need for us to keep with us as because it is available to us. So this is how he talk, I mean, of course, this is what Jayan Mohanty said. I'm trying to apply it to Habermas. So the Habermasian concept of life world got multiple meaning. Multiple meaning in the sense, a structure which is permanent, which cannot be changed, and which can never undergo any change, is replaced by the life world. That's why he says decoupling of, they are coupled together. In fact, life world and system are two forms of human existence, he says. But one is very rigid, so it is necessary for us to move towards the life world. But we should remember the fact when we are moving towards the life world, there is a question which actually has to be examined properly. Who has the liberty to interpret a certain concept? Because many of the concepts are being interpreted. Now, who has the liberty or who can do this job? But I have a different way of analyzing this issue. In fact, I have a detailed paper on this, but now I'm not going to discuss this. So in short, I would like to say that Habermas has reconstructed rationalism through the communicative action by what is known as the life world. In life world, in short, we can say social solidarity is possible, interpretation is possible, and whenever we need, we can give different interpretation for a concept so that we can make the thing very relevant. So I will discuss Habermas in a very brief way, of course. How far I was clear, I don't know. But I made my humble attempt to show how communicative action is meaningful and how ideal speech situation is very much essential. Now, with this, because I have some reservation towards this theory, which I have given in my slide, but now I want to discuss something on Indian philosophy of language, so I skip that. Now, Indian philosophy of language. Now, in Indian philosophy of language, we have this very interesting notion. What is that? That is, we talk about concepts, we talk about things of this world, and we also talk about supersensible reality by using the same language. So, which means in Indian philosophical tradition, as the Canadian professor J.G. Arapura, of course, he was Indian, he says that Indian philosophers have carefully avoided the reductionistic mistakes. Two reductionist mistakes. Now, one is now that is language can be used at the phenomenal level. Language phenomenal level, wherein we say language is used in order to communicate all our ideas. Now, the Western philosophy of language is based on that. The language is a mode of communication. There ends the job of language. Except, of course, Heidegger, who compares being with language and all that. But normally, in Western tradition, language is used in order to communicate our ideas and thoughts. That's fine. But there is also another way by which we can use language. That is a metaphysical dimension of language. Now, the metaphysical dimension of language, the same language which is used in order to talk about the entities of this world, is used in order to talk about the super sensuous reality. So this means language has two dimensions in Indian tradition. And Arapura says we have avoided this two reductionism. We are not reduced language either to this phenomenal level, which the Westerners have done, or to a mere metaphysical level, because we use the same language in order to talk about the metaphysical reality, because we don't have any other language. But we always say that there is a limitation. And the best example that is given is Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. This example is given in order to tell that we cannot take the literal meaning of the statement. When you say the lily, the flower lily, the lily is big, blue and fragrant, okay? We can say the lily, the flower lily is blue in color and it is fragrant and all that one. These are the characteristics or the attributes of the flower lily. But with regard to Brahman, when you say Satyajnanam Anantam Brahma, Satyajnanam Anantam are not the attributes of Brahman. Then what is the meaning? Here we say, in order to say that Brahman is non-different from Asatyam, in order to show that Brahman is non-different from Asatyam, we use Satyam. So there is a limitation, which means there is no other language. So we have to use only the language that is available to us. So, but we have the limitation of language. And of course, we have elaborately discussed that in Indian philosophy language. And there are great scholars who have discussed this approach. My teacher, Professor R. Balasubramanian, then Professor Arapura, then K. Sachidananda Murthy, then K. Kunjini Raja. These are some of the thinkers who talked about these issues in detail. Now, Shabda is a very important Indian philosophical tradition, because as I said in the beginning of my lecture, that in the empirical level, it is used in order to communicate our ideas. And here we depend on the trustworthy person. Now, a trustworthy person is one who always makes statements which are relevant or which are true and which are accepted by all. And the same has been emphasized by Habermas in a different way altogether. This is very important, but I would never claim that what all Habermas has said has been long been anticipated by Indian philosophical tradition. No, that is not my aim. My aim is to draw certain parallels. Now, another important concept which I would like to discuss here is how the dialogue between or the dialectic between the Mimamsakas and the Advaitins very clearly talk about something similar to communicative action of Habermas, for which, of course, in Indian philosophy, language is something very rich. In fact, we talk about what is the meaning of the word, what is the sentence meaning, what is the unit of language. A detailed discussion is very much available, but I would here take the sentence, the two theories of sentence meaning, which has a direct relevance to my talk, namely the dialectic between the Advaitins and the Mimamsakas. There are two, all of us know that there are two theories of sentence and its meaning. Anvita Bidhanavada is a very interesting theory. Anvita Bidhanavada developed by the Prabhakara Mimamsakas. And the second theory is Abhidhanvayavada, developed by the Nayayikas. The Nayayikas and the Bhattas. Now, let me very briefly explain. Of course, there are experts in this group, but for the sake of students, and in fact, my entire lecture is for the benefit of students. So, let me explain very briefly these two theories. Now, in Anvita Bidhanavada, we say words in a sentence not only convey their individual meanings, but also the construed meaning of the sentence. So Prabhakara here speaks about the natural method by which children learn the meaning of words. So it is by watching, the Prabhakaras very clearly say, it is by watching the usage and activity of elders in daily life that children come to know the meaning. That is how, by watching the elders, the children learn the language. For example, take a sentence like, bring the cow. when the child hears the statement, when its father makes the statement, bring the cow, then immediately the servant or somebody brings the cow. Okay. But we can't say from this the child has understood the meaning of the cow, meaning of the word, meaning of the sentence. And next time, the father says, untie the cow. Right? So then some action is taking place. When she says, bring the cow, some action is followed. Then similarly, and the child observes this action, the statement and the action that is followed. And similarly, when the father says, untie the cow, some action is taking place. So the child, by comparing these two sentences, it understands the meaning of the word cow. So Indian philosophical tradition argues that this is how we learn the language. We learn the language, that especially children learn the language. So by similarly, we bring the horse. When we make this statement, bring the horse, then bring the cow. So from this, they understand the meaning of the word cow and cow, horse, etc. Similarly, the act of bringing. Now, anything that is uttered is known by the action that is followed. So thus, by comparing the various sentences uttered by people and by observing the actions produced, this is very important, we get the meaning. So a sentence is uttered, then immediately some action is followed, and as a result of that, we understand the meaning of that. Now, what is important is how the Prabhakaras apply this theory in the Vedic context. That is, the Vedas, according to the Prabhakaras, is essentially, we know, is nothing but the book of commandments. Because they talks about injunctions, it talks about prohibitions, that is what we call the vidivakyas. So the injunctive sentences which produce a visible reaction, that is, when we hear a injunctive sentence, a visible reaction is produced on the part of the hearer. And hence, it is only from the injunctive sentences the meaning of the words is understood. Now, please note that the Prabhakaras, who are mainly concerned about the injunctive statements or vidivakyas, are concerned about how we understand the meaning of the sentence. Now, how about an assertive sentence? With regard to injunctive sentence, it is very clear. Because when we hear that something is taking place, so only in the context of injunction one can understand. Now, how about assertive sentence? That is, we call it Siddha Vastu Bodhaka Vakya. Siddha Vastu Bodhaka Vakyas. Now, how do we understand the assertive sentence? Do we apply the same methodology? Now, the Mimamsakas very beautifully say, the assertive sentences found in the Vedas are significant, okay, significant only when they are constructed in appropriate injunctive sentence. That is, whatever sentence which are available, which are assertive in nature, which are available in the Vedas, could be understood only in the context of a injunctive text. Now, the issue is that if the meanings of the words is known when they occur in injunctive sentence, it means that every word must express its meaning only in relation to injunction. Now, it means, you see how the Mimamsakas try to develop an argument here. Now, first they say, injunctive sentence alone are meaningful because it provokes or it makes a person to perform some action. Then if the question is asked about assertive also, they say it should be studied in or construed in relation to the injunctive sentence. That's fine. Then they say, if that be the case, then they say that in each and every sentence or statement, verb is a nucleus. This is a very beautiful contribution of Mimamsakas. They say the verb expressing an action is the nucleus of the sentence. Because in injunctive sentences, either you perform an action or you are forbidden to perform an action, right? Now, so this implies that whenever a statement is uttered, the verb becomes a nucleus of the sentence, which means the verb, which is a nucleus of the sentence, because it talks about the action. The verb talks about the action, and around it, other agent are connected. So what does this mean? I'll repeat. In a sentence, the verb is important, because the verb takes us to some action. So what is the other components like the agent, the object, etc.? All are important, but they go round this verb or action. So all sentences are action-oriented sentence. This argument of Anvita Bitanavada has been severely criticized by Abhidhanvayavada. Now, according to this theory, that is Abhidhanvayavada, the meaning of a sentence is nothing but a concatenation of individual items expressed by the words. So words have meaning of their own independently of the sentence in which they are embedded. So what does this mean? This means that in a sentence, the individual meanings of words come after one another, and the first one, the second one, they follow one another, and it is followed by the conditions which are adopted, namely akanksha, yogyata, and asakti. So these conditions are applied in order to have the full meaning. So what is the difference in Anvita Bidhanavada? The words in a sentence not only convey the individual meaning. For example, cow eats grass. Cow has a particular meaning. The word has a meaning. Eat has got a meaning. Grass. So all these words convey not only their individual meaning, but also their construed meaning. Now this has been rejected now. Now this Abhidhanvayavada is a very powerful theory, no doubt. But the Bhatta Mimamsakas, for example, they do not accept the Prabhakara. That is, they do not accept the Anvita Bitanavada, that all words in a sentence are related to the verbs. So the major objection towards Anvita Bitanavada is that verb is a nucleus, that in all sentences, the verb play a very important role because it involves a person to perform some action or other. Now, the Bhattas give a very beautiful example. They say, in a sentence, very beautiful argument. In fact, they say, in a sentence, bring the white cow. White cow, the adjective white is connected with the noun cow and not directly with the verb bring. Now, you see how the dialogue goes between these two traditions. Now, where do we place the Advaitins? This is my major worry. Where do we place it? Now, Advaitins are divided among themselves with regard to this two sentence theories, Vachaspati, Chitsuga, and then Madhusudana Saraswati advocate the Bhatta Mimamsaka view. So, which means they follow the Abhidhanvayavada. But the authors of Vivarana and Vivarana Prameya Sangraha, this is another text. So, the authors, they do not accept this. And what is the position of Shankara? Because I am very much curious to know about Shankara. So I asked this question to our teacher, Professor R. Balasubramaniam. He said, though Shankara has not explicitly mentioned which theory is tenable, because there are two theories just now, you know. So where do we place Shankara? But my teacher R.B. says that Shankara accepts Abhidhanvayavada. This is what he said. But there is one question. What is that? Though some of the Advaitins accept one and two, and some accept, Shankara accept the first one, though some Advaitins accept both views, they do not agree with the view of the Prabhakaras in full. What is that? Because in Prabhakara, Prabhakara Mimamsaka, we said that verb is the nucleus of the sentence. So they are attacking that. Now you see the metaphysical or the ontological commitment of these two systems. They're very beautifully said. The Prabhakara, since they are more concerned about action and action-oriented sentence injunction, they talk give special importance to a verb or action. But Advaitins do not accept the action-oriented sentence. So they say it is not necessary for every word in a sentence to be related to verb alone. So Advaitins simply rejects the Prabhakaras according to which action is the import of all sentences. Now we see it is very clear from this dialogue that for the Advaitins, the action is not the import of all sentences. But the matter has not ended because Indian philosophers know that the very great tradition. You know, there is a dialogue, a counter dialogue, and this goes on forever. Such a beautiful approach is very much available in classical Indian philosophy. And that's why one should be in a position to understand the implications of classical Indian philosophy in the background of Western tradition. Not that to say that something is great and something is inferior, no. That is, you can see how two different traditions talk about the same issue or issues which are very similar. So in fact, it is very much essential because now we are trying to apply the Western, I have been applying the Western model to Indian philosophical tradition. This has been my project all the time. In fact, in one of the seminars, somebody said, why do you apply the Western method to Indian philosophy? I said that method is convenient to me and I am little okay with that method. I'm comfortable with that, so I am apply that. If you are comfortable with the Indian tradition, you can apply that Indian to Western. In fact, this is very much essential. It is very much essential for us to apply some of the Indian technique to Western methodology and see how far it is acceptable to them or how far they are right. It is not the case that all the time they are right. No. Now, I will go back to that. I'll be finishing in another few minutes. I'm sorry, I'm taking a lot of time, I think. Now, what is the, you know, the dialogue is going to conclude now. Of course, the dialogue is still continuing, but for the time being, we have to conclude that. Now, I said, for the Advaitins, there is no action-oriented sentences. Okay, that's fine. But for the Prabhakaras, all sentences are action-oriented. Now, take one assertive sentence like, a son is born to you. A son is born to you. Now, when somebody hears a person, when a statement, it may not, underline the word may not prompt a person to action. Simply might reason, assume that the person is working somewhere, and when somebody phones him and say, a son is born to you, he can't come immediately perhaps. So he may simply keep quiet or he will say, hey, okay, happy. So it does not involve a person to perform an action. It only refers to a certain state of affair. No doubt they have communicated competence. This person has, when the person hears the statement, no doubt he has got communicated competence, but he is simply keeping quiet. Because for him, it is only a state of affairs. Now, Mandana, for example, says that when a person listens to the statement, there is nothing to be done by him. As there is no scope for action because he is staying somewhere else. So far, he is concerned either with regard to the means, that is upaya, namely childbirth, or the end, that is upaya, that is happiness. So when we hear a sentence, there is no action that is involved. This is what the Mandana is trying to argue. Now, let me quote another example. There is wealth in this place. There is wealth in this place. That is, we're pointing the earth, we say that there is some treasure, wealth in this place. So when we hear this statement, the person who hears this statement may not perform any action. So this person simply hears some information from the other. So after hearing this, he may not be interested to dig the ground and take the wealth. So he may keep quiet. So where is the action that is involved? There is action that is involved in this assertive sentences. So all sentences are action oriented according to the Mimamsakas. But the Advaitins say it is not the case. But I'm stopping it. But the argument further goes. In fact, Mimamsakas say, no, it is not the case. When you hear the statement, the son is born to you, at least there is some reaction in the face of the person. So that itself is an action. So this is some very beautiful discussion is very much available in Indian literature. Now, so this is some parallel I am attempting to show between these two traditions. Now, I would like to conclude by saying these points. First of all, the ideal speech situation of Habermas, in fact, I said that I had a dialogue with Habermas in the year 2000 at Frankfurt. So I asked him whether this ideal speech situation which he speaks of, whether it would be applicable to Asian countries, especially in India. He simply said, yeah, it is applicable to any situation. But we should understand that what all he has talked about is only applicable to the framework of the Westerners. That means only it will work. The ideal speech situation will work only in Western context. It would be a failure, and it has been a failure in an Indian context. Because in fact, Habermas, some critics like Roderick, they say that the problem is, how are you going to implement that? Ideal speech situation, because you say that it is something which is very much essential for understanding the other, but how is it possible? Be practical. That's what the critics say. For which Habermas replied, they say, yeah, that is true, but I am assuming a situation that if the ideal speech situation arises, what would be the nature? How the world, the entire world would change? So this is a case of utopia, I would say. But something is remarkable because he is trying to show that there should be equality among the speakers and the listeners. This is a very beautiful idea. But in Indian context, it is very difficult, I would say, because in the classroom, we never give a chance for the students to ask questions. During my university days, we were never allowed to open our mouth. Great professors would come, speak, talk, and go. That's all. So we allow the students to ask the questions. So not only that, assume a situation. The officer and the servant, or in IT companies where there is boss and workers, where is this ideal speech situation possible? So these are some of the problems with regard to ideal speech situation. But the communicative action is something remarkable, because he could show that all communication is action oriented, wherein we say the social solidarity is possible. One more point, with that I conclude. Now, very important contribution of Habermas is that he has moved or he has shifted from philosophy of language to discourse. This is a very important contribution of thinkers like Ricoeur or Derrida or Gadamer. Now, what is important is, no doubt, but all these thinkers acknowledge the contributions of philosophy of language. Thanks to Wittgenstein. But they say it is a transitional stage. We have to move from this transitional stage, that is from this philosophy of language to discourse. In fact, Ricoeur, in The Rule of Metaphor, very beautifully argues that how language has taken us to philosophy of language. right? So where we utter something and the meaning is communicated, but he said, no, this is not enough. What we need is a discourse where we participate. There should be action. Now action here means some response. So in this way, this communicative action has some advantages, but a study of this communicative action would reveal to us that there are many parallels which are available in indentation. So this is not something alien to our tradition. We can also, the only my main argument is that if we properly understand Indian philosophical tradition, then we can see the beauty of it. But we fail to do that. In fact, this is the last sentence. When I made an attempt, because my book, PhD thesis was on Wittgenstein and Shankara, when I took this topic, many were amazed. They say that, how is it possible? The only person who gave me a lot of encouragement was Professor K. Chajanamurthy. Many said, how could you compare the theory of meaning of Wittgenstein with Shankara? But now we are talking Wittgenstein from Indian perspective. So this is possible. So it is very much essential for us to talk about how two traditions can have a dialogue. In fact, I feel that in the phenomenology, we are now making an attempt to show that how divergent views can give a possible solution to many of the philosophical issues which we are confronting. So with this, I stop. I don't know how far I was successful in my attempt. So I would be happy if there are some questions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, thank you very much, sir, for delivering such a beautiful and meaningful lecture.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you
again. Thank you,
sir.
Now I invite Professor Keshi Pandey, sir, to make a comment on this talk. Professor Pandey, sir.
Hello.
Are you?
Yes.
Thank you. Please, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rajendra. I'm amazed. I'm basically amazed to see that how could we have traveled from Habermas, Gadamer, Rotary, Foucault, Derrida, that is the contemporary Western philosophy of language, to Indian philosophy of language, Abhitanvevad, Anvaita Vidhanvad, in Nyayika's point of view, Bhat Mimamsaka's point of view, then Advaita Vedantin point of view. So, and then the culmination of the interchanging of the methodologies of the two, and probably this is the time that we should keep applying Western methodology to Indian context and Indian methodology to Western context in order to understand both in a better manner. So Professor Pani Selvam's book, that is Wittgenstein and Shankara, has been the point of talk in our fourth Wittgenstein conference held in Lucknow in last December. And many people have asked for a photocopy of that book, and that really is a book which I think is the current need for all of us to go through once again, and request Professor Pani Selvam to have a second edition of this book. With this few words, basically, I would like to request Dr. Prashant Shukla, our colleague, to make a brief account of the talk for those who have problem in understanding English. And maybe he could summarize in a very brief for Hindi students and scholars. Dr. Prashant Shukla.
Thanks a lot, sir. सबसे पहले मैं धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा प्रोफेसर पेनी सेल्वम सर को. सर, आप हम लोग के लिए एक रोल मॉडल की तरह हैं जब भी हम पोस्ट मॉडर्निज्म को समझना चाहते हैं. सर के इस प्रस्तुतिकरण का प्रमुख उद्देश्य दो उद्देश्यों को पूर्ण करना था. पहला, हेबरमास के कम्युनिकेटिव एक्शन, जिसको हम लोग हिंदी में अपनी सुविधा के अनुसार संवाद क्रिया का सिद्धांत कहकर बुलाते हैं, इसे भारतीय संदर्भों में किस प्रकार समझा जाए. और नंबर दो, मीमांस और अद्वैत परंपरा जो कि एक शास्त्रीय परंपरा है, इसमें विद्यमान शास्त्रार्थ की परंपरा से हेबमास के संवाद क्रिया सिद्धांत की तुलना यदि की जाए तो किस प्रकार की जाए? प्रोफेसर पेनिसेल्वम ने बीके मतीलाल जी का उद्धरण लेते हुए आरंभ किया और कहा, इट इज फिलोसॉफिकली इंपॉर्टेंट टू इंक्वायर व्हाई सिमिलर पजल्स प्रोड्यूस डिफरेंट आंसर्स इन डिफरेंट कॉन्टेक्स्ट। एक दर्शन शास्त्री के तौर पर हम ये जानना चाहेंगे कि समान प्रकार के प्रश्न अलग अलग संदर्भों में अलग अलग प्रकार के उत्तर क्यों उत्पन्न करते हैं। हेबमास जिनके अनेकानेक ग्रंथों में से प्रोफेसर पेनिसेल्वम मुख्य रूप से उनके दो मैग्नम ओपस प्रमुख ग्रंथों का संदर्भ लेते हैं, जो कि हैं नॉलेज एंड ह्यूमन इंटरेस्ट और थ्योरी ऑफ कम्युनिकेटिव एक्शन। वो आरंभ में ही कह देते हैं कि हेबमास के अनुसार इसे हम संवाद क्रिया इसलिए कह करके बुलाएंगे क्योंकि संवाद को प्रस्तुत करते समय भी एक क्रिया को परिपन्न करने का प्रयास किया जा रहा है। तो हर संवाद, हर शास्त्रार्थ, हर संवाद स्वयं में एक क्रिया को जन्म देता है। आरंभ में वो कहते हैं कि हम इस संवाद क्रिया को ह्यूमन इंटरेस्ट या मानव हित के साथ जोड़कर देखने का प्रयास करेंगे, क्योंकि ऐसे संवाद और ऐसी क्रिया का भला क्या लाभ जिसे हम मानवीय हितों के साथ जोड़कर न देख पाए। यहाँ पर हेबरमास तीन भिन्न प्रकार के मानवीय हितों की बात करते हैं, ह्यूमन इंटरेस्ट की बात करते हैं, जहां पे सबसे पहले वो ज्ञान, जैसा कि इससे पहले माना गया आधुनिकता का के काल में माना गया, इसकी उग्र आलोचना प्रस्तुत करना चाहते हैं। दूसरे बिंदु पर वो ट्रेडिशनल एपिस्टेमोलॉजी अर्थात हमारी पारंपरिक ज्ञान मीमांसा में त्रुटियों को प्रदर्शित करने का प्रयास करते हैं। और तीसरे बिंदु पे जैसे थियोडोर एडॉर्नो कहते हैं, वो ये सिद्ध करना चाहते हैं कि पारंपरिक ज्ञान मीमांसा की आलोचना करना, उसमें सुधार करना अति आवश्यक है। उन्होंने हमें बताया कि प्रमुखता हम तीन तरह के मानवीय हितों की बात कर रहे हैं। पहला, जिसे हम एम्पिरिकल इंटरेस्ट, कभी कभी टेक्निकल इंटरेस्ट या आनुभविक हित की बात कहते हैं। दूसरा, इंस्ट्रूमेंटल इंटरेस्ट, जिसे हम उपकरण परक हित की बात करते हैं। और तीसरा, जिसे हमने इमेंसिपेटरी इंटरेस्ट की बात कही, अर्थात जो हमें अतीन्द्रियता, मुक्ति, स्वतंत्रता और स्वायत्तता की ओर ले जाता है। अभी तक हमने देखा था कि पॉजिटिविस्ट सदैव सिर्फ और सिर्फ एक हित की बात करते हैं, लेकिन हेबमास यहाँ पे तीन भिन्न प्रकार के सामाजिक और दार्शनिक हितों की चर्चा कर रहे हैं। और इस प्रकार वो व्हाट इज से व्हाट ऑट टू बी की तरफ जाने का प्रयास भी कर रहे हैं, अर्थात तथ्यों के साथ साथ मूल्यों को भी संपृक्त करने का प्रयास कर रहे हैं। तो इस प्रकार वो इस और डिकोटॉमी को भी मिनिमाइज करने का प्रयास अपने इस सिद्धांत, अपनी स्टोरी में करते हैं। किंतु उनके अनुसार ऐसा तभी हो पाएगा जब हम इसे मोनोलॉग नहीं, डायलॉग नहीं, बल्कि एक मल्टीलॉग या पॉलीलॉग के रूप में स्थापित करना चाहें, जहां पे स्पीकर और अटरर अर्थात कहने वाले और सुनने वाले के बीच एक सामंजस्य परक संबंध, एक सिमेट्रिकल रिलेशनशिप बनाई जा सके। ऐसा तभी हो जाएगा तब दोनों के प्लेटफॉर्म, दोनों के कॉन्टेक्स्ट और दोनों का लाइफ वर्ड अर्थात डिजाइन एक समान हो। और इस प्रकार संदर्भ हेबमास के लिए अत्यंत महत्वपूर्ण बन जाता है। इसके पश्चात वो आइडियल स्पीच सिचुएशन अर्थात आदर्श वाक परिस्थिति की बात करते हैं और कहते हैं, कम्युनिकेटिव एक्शन या संवाद क्रिया तभी संपूर्ण की जा सकती है जब आदर्श परिस्थितियों का पालन किया जाए। और इसमें चार परिस्थितियों की या चार मापदंडों की चर्चा की गई है। पहला, देयर शुड बी इंटेलिजिबिलिटी ऑफ द अटरेंस, यानी कि जो बात कही गई उसे पूर्ण रूप से समझा जा सके। नंबर टू, देयर शुड बी ट्रूथ ऑफ प्रपोजिशनल कंटेंट, अर्थात जिस प्रतिज्ञप्ति के सार तत्व को प्रस्तुत किया गया है वो सत्य ही हो। नंबर थ्री, देयर शुड बी करेक्टनेस ऑफ परफॉर्मेटरी कंपोनेंट, अर्थात उस क्रिया में एक औचित्य छुपा हो, और चौथा सिंसियरिटी अर्थात ईमानदारी का गुण उसमें विद्यमान हो, अर्थात जो कहा जा रहा है वही भावना भी है। और इस प्रकार हेबामास डिक्लेरेटिव क्लेम अर्थात वस्तुनिष्ठता सत्यता की भी बात करते हैं, और नॉर्मेटिव क्लेम अर्थात नियामक आयाम अर्थात उचित होने की भी बात अपनी थ्योरी और प्रैक्टिस में करते हैं। इसके पश्चात वो कम्युनिकेटिव रैशनैलिटी जैसे शब्द का प्रयोग करते हैं, जहां पर उनका कहना है यदि हम तर्क बुद्धि को स्थापित करना चाहें तो ये सिर्फ और सिर्फ संवाद के माध्यम से ही हो सकता है, मोनोलॉग कभी भी रैशनैलिटी नहीं प्रस्तुत कर सकते। और इसके लिए हेबामास सब्जेक्ट सेंटर्ड रीजन को डिवीजन का प्रोडक्ट मानकर चलते हैं, और हमेशा इंटर सब्जेक्टिव रीजन को स्थापित करने का प्रयास करते हैं, अर्थात बौद्धिकता एक पारस्परिक संवाद के द्वारा ही स्थापित की जा सकती है। और इस प्रकार वो इंटर सब्जेक्टिव कम्युनिकेशन और सोशल सॉलिडेरिटी दोनों को एक साथ अपने सिद्धांत में समाहित करने का प्रयास करते हैं। इसके पश्चात अंततः प्रोफेसर पेनिसेल्वम ने मीमांसा और वेदांत के भारतीय संदर्भ के साथ उनकी एक तुलना करते हुए ये दिखाने का प्रयास किया कि प्रभाकर गुरु के अन्विधाभिधानवाद और कुमारिल भट्ट के अभिहितानवायवाद में भी कुछ ऐसे तत्व विद्यमान हैं जिनकी उचित तुलना हेबामास के कम्युनिकेटिव एक्शन के साथ की जा सकती है, यद्यपि दोनों के संदर्भ अलग अलग होंगे। उनका ये कहना और ये सर्व स्वीकार्य भी है कि यदि हमें अंतर विषय या अंतर संदर्भ में एक शोध प्रस्तुत करना है तो क्यों न हम पाश्चात्य विधियों का आरोपण भारतीय दर्शन पर, और यदि संभव हो तो भारतीय विधियों का आरोपण पाश्चात्य दर्शन के सिद्धांतों पर भी करने का प्रयास करें। धन्यवाद सर।
थैंक यू सो मच डॉक्टर। The entire talk presented in a different language. So for students' sake, I suppose that that was needed. And now the talk is open for discussion. And let me invite one by one. That is Anurima Bhattacharya. Are you listening me? Anurima, yes, sir. Yes. Please come and ask your question.
Chat box.
You're not audible.
Yes, sir. Can you hear me?
Yeah, very dim voice.
Okay. Am I audible, sir?
Now a little bit. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Sir, my first question is that how can the sentence "the flower is red" be action oriented according to the Prabhakaras? Okay. This is the first question. And second, I will go back to your description of Habermas's this communicative action. And you were talking of consensus. You were talking of social solidarity. If these are the key features of communicative action, and if we are talking of rationality in the sense of being social rationality, where everybody is allowed to speak, so it includes every people to speak, so naturally there will be disagreements. Even when it is a dialogue or it is a polylogue, when everybody is speaking, if it is social rationality, then where is the conformity that they will all come to a consensus? They may disagree and still they may communicate very much with one another. There can be very good communication even when they disagree. So where is the necessity that it will result in social solidarity or consensus along with rationality being social? Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes. Sir.
Okay. Thank you very much for your wonderful questions. Now, with regard to the first one, when you say the flower is red, now, Prabhakaras are mainly concerned about the injunctive sentences which are available in the Vedas and the assertive sentences which are available in Vedas. So this means whenever we come across an assertive sentence, this we have to see whether this could be seen along with the injunctive sentences. So unless there is some injunction which is connected to the assertive sentences, or if we cannot read a sentence along with this injunctive sentences, then such sentences are not acceptable to the Mimamsakas. Then with regard to the social solidarity, yeah, this is a very important question. Thank you very much. Now, there will be disagreement, no doubt. But if we, I mean, according to Habermas, if we have a disagreement among the speakers and the hearers or the listeners, that is not a wrong way of a dialogue. In fact, he says by developing disagreement among us at one point of time, there is a possibility that a consensus may arise. But he himself is not very sure in the sense, that's why, I mean, the critics say, that's why he calls it as ideal speech situation. This is something which we have not achieved so far, but like Plato's form or this thing, it is an utopian concept, but think about a possibility. How it would be, how the world would be if there is a consensus. But the consensus may not be there, but and disagreement is will be there forever. But in spite of that, we are trying to reach a solidarity. Now, his purpose, we have to see the background in which it has emerged. So he is concerned about how do we understand the other. Do we understand the other? No, definitely not, according to Habermas. So he is trying to see the possibility where we can arrange or where we can come to an agreement. So it is an attempt. How far it is successful in the context of social solidarity is a question. But we are attempting, that's all. I mean, Habermas is attempting and I am with him, that's all.
May I ask one question?
Yes, sir. Please ask. Dr. Tandon.
Dr. Pandey?
Yeah.
Hello, ji. Good morning.
Yeah. Good morning, sir.
Very nice.
I'm presenting Habermas because you are the person in India who can represent Habermas views. I have two questions.
Please,
one
sir.
How is Habermas' critique of reason different from the critique of reason by the postmodernists, when you talk about Derrida, Foucault, etc. And because we know that Habermas is considered as a modernist, so there must be some distinction between the two. And the next question is that when you say that the ideal speech situation is not possible in South Asia or in the context of India, it is not possible even in Europe, I think. But my question is, how would you compare Gandhi's approach of satyagraha to reach a sort of consensus by understanding the other and making the other to understand oneself by undergoing some sort of suffering? So, in that case, we can reach some sort of consensus or not. And I think that this is a very practical, political question. But I think that if ideal speech situation is not there, even in imperfect speech situation, we can go for some sort of, we can say, samvada or communicative action in Gandhian lines.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Alok Tandonji, for your wonderful questions. It is nice to see you, first of all. I am thankful to you for your kind observation. Now, two important questions, no doubt. One is, how does it differ from the postmodern understanding, critique of reason? Yeah, the postmodern is also attack reason. But they say, I mean, the grounds are, I would say, are more or less similar, because the postmodernists also say that there is what is called oppression and domination, which is very much visible in reason. That is the reason why they want to shift But Habermas is different, but though he says he's a modernist, I would always place him in postmodern tradition. Many of my friends, I don't know whether they will accept it or not, but I am very comfortable, whether he would be comfortable or not, but I would be very comfortable in placing Habermas in the postmodern.
No, I am not comfortable. He will always say that modernity has got some...
Because he says it is an unfinished project, no doubt. Project. But that statement or that analysis would not place him in the modernist tradition. But what is interesting, what is important here is that how he has redefined reason so that, because now, for example, I was quoting Horkheimer and I don't know, wherein it is said that how the reason has turned into the opposite. And he says there are some aspects which you have to celebrate in reason. So his approach is something different from other thinkers who have talked about reason. So I would say that his approach would come very close to the postmodern rejection of reason. So he, in fact, in simple terms, I would say he has redefined or remodified the concept of reason, and he has not simply rejected the notion of reason. Now, the second question is very important. I would say ideal speech situation. Now, ideal speech situation, now when I was having a dialogue with him, I asked this question, especially in India or in South Asian countries where there is what we call hierarchy between the speaker and the hearer. In fact, I was making my attempt to explain to him the concept of Varna, where there is hierarchy, how the Indian society has been classified and how it is, discussed in social context and all that one. And he says, yeah, that's true. But he says, by making certain amendments in constitution, we can make the ideal speech situation a reality. I would definitely accept with you this paradigm of Habermas has a limitation, no doubt. But the Gandhian model, and in fact, I would say that this is a very beautiful model, which is very very much available to us. And this model of Gandhi would take us to some consensus. Though there may be there also, we can't say that there is an absolute consensus among all. But to a large extent, I would say that the Gandhian model is very much relevant in this context, rather than the ideal speech situation, which itself is an ideal and which is an utopian concept.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much.
So,
thank you.
There are a few more questions. Could we take, sir?
Yeah, no problem.
So,
please.
Some more questions are here. And the questions which are raised in the chat box, there is one question by Ananya Mishra, and then there are questions by Amita, and then Purbayan,
okay.
And then Prashant. So please come and ask your questions freely. Ananya, maybe. Ananya, Purbayan, Amita, Prashant, anybody?
So can I ask questions, sir? Amita,
yeah,
Valmiki?
Yeah, Amita, yeah.
Yeah, sir, I was feeling that Habermas' theory of language is more inclusive than Indian theory, because all the time Indian theory reflects some kind of, as you mentioned, the hierarchy. Secondly, Habermas incorporates Carl Jaspers' dialogical communication from existence to existence, and also I think the participation theory of Paul Tillich, which is very much reflected in his language theory. And this brings about solidarity, because I think Arunima, when she asked about where is the one consensus, you can't build up consensus. I think you build up consensus to agree on disagreeing. And this particular concept is reflected and brings about world solidarity in Habermas, but which is not as, this theory is not reflected, this ideology is not reflected in Indian theory of language, especially even Shabda, for example, you take it, even Advaitin or Mimamsa. As you mentioned, there is some hierarchy. And how to break this? And why can't we have a dialogue between Western and Indian? Why we have kept ourselves so exclusive? Why? Why we are not being inclusive? That is my question. And worry also.
Yeah. thank you, Professor Amita ji, for your wonderful questions. And I'm happy to see you. And thank you very much for your questions. Now, I would like to, I agree with you with regard to the first point, namely that Habermas is more inclusive. No doubt that when he develops this ideal speech situation or theory of communicative action, it is definitely inclusive because there is a space for other and there is no hierarchy and all that one. So there is no doubt about that. But with regard to Indian theories, each system is complete by itself. In the sense, you are aware of the fact that in Indian philosophical theories, we are guided by the ontological commitment. That is, we are guided by the metaphysical principles. Which means each system or each thinker has a particular approach, and he can think only within that system, and it is not possible for a particular thinker to embrace the opposite view. So, but there, I would say that each system is complete by itself. They give a perfect understanding of their system. But if we extend this further to other systems, then the problem comes. So I would say it is a little problematic, I would say, to approach this, to apply this methodology fully to Indian context. But there is hierarchy, no doubt. It cannot be avoided. And second, so the dialogue is possible. In fact, many of our contemporary thinkers are making some attempt to have a dialogue with the Westerners and the Westerners with India. But what would happen is that at one stage or other, that dialogue abruptly stops. Now, I'll give one example from Jayakrishna. So Jayakrishna was having this Sambhada, this thing, dialogue, and also what we call the Jaipur experiment. In fact, some of us attended this workshop, wherein he was trying to have a dialogue with the Westerners, with the Indian traditional scholars. But it has stopped. Why? Because, for example, the word like sentence and proposition. There is some difficulty in giving the equivalent meaning or equivalent word to this sentence or proposition in Indian approach, and there are many difficulties. That is the reason why we say that Indian philosophical tradition, especially philosophy language, I'm more interested in philosophy language, complete in itself. But the problem is that when we come for a dialogue, there is some limitation. I would further go and say that Suresh Chandra, a great professor of India, he said that the philosophers in India are of three kinds. One is one who is well-versed in Sanskrit. They are great scholars, great pandits, we can always learn from them. But unfortunately, they are unable to communicate their ideas to the West. Secondly, there are philosophers who write only on Western philosophy, purely on Western philosophy. And the third category of philosophers are one who writes both on Indian and Western. So they are making some attempt or methodology, apply the Western methodology to Indian tradition or Indian methodology to Western, and say how far a dialogue is possible. Now, all these three great teachers, I mean, three classification of teachers are very important, but they are perfect in their approach, but they are not ready to come out and have a dialogue with others. Especially the third category of philosophers are ready to have a dialogue with the Westerners and the Westerners within India, with the Indian thinkers. But there is some limitation, no doubt. But I think, I strongly feel that this cultural dialogue between Eastern and Western would definitely take us further. And I would say that in future, that is going to be a best method of doing philosophy.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
There are questions from Ananya, Purbayan, and Prashant. So, Ananya is there?
Yes, sir.
Would you like to ask certain question? Why are you not having your video on?
Sir, I'm
okay,
on.
Right. Let me ask you a question.
Sir, I just wanted to ask that, like, you said that communicative rationality can only be established in a discourse, and in authentic discourse, the speaker and listener are symmetric. So when can we say that speaker and listener are symmetric? Is there a set condition or a pattern when we'll say that the listener and speaker are symmetric? And also a second question, that does social rationality limit the scope of interdisciplinary discourse? Thank you, sir.
Okay. Second one, please repeat.
Does social rationality limit the scope of interdisciplinary discourse?
Yeah. Thank you very much for your interesting questions. Now, with regard to the first one, discourse. Now, remember in the beginning itself, I said that there is a need for us to move from language to discourse. In language, what do we say? That in language, we utter a statement and the other person knows the meaning of it. That may be true. For example, I can make a statement that a missing child was taken away by a dragon. That's also a statement. That is written in a language, particular language, either Hindi or Tamil or English. But how far you accept the content or the meaning of my statement? Now, in discourse, this is not possible. In discourse, we expect the utterer, that is, when I say something, it must be true. It must be meaningful. I should not think as because the listener is there to make a statement like the missing child was taken away by a dragon, I cannot make such a statement. So this means in a discourse, there is always participation. In participation, which means there is a symmetrical relation where the equanimity is maintained between the speaker and the hearer. But there are certain limitations, no doubt. Now, what is the limitation? I mean, there are certain guiding principles. Remember, I gave four important principles. One of the principles I said is the speaker must tell the truth. The speaker must make the authentic statement. That's why I said in Sabda, we talk about trustworthy person statement. We don't question that. Because no, we believe the trustworthy person. So whatever he says must be true. Similarly, in a discourse, whenever the utterer says something, the hearer or the listener believes because it must be true. So these are the conditions, which are the four conditions, which are very much essential in order to have a discourse. And this is possible provided both the speaker and the hearer have no hidden agenda. They are open. So then second question is with regard to social remedial limits to interdependence. No, definitely not. In fact, I would say it encourages interdisciplinary research. And I have a very strong feeling that only social rationality can promote the interdisciplinary approach. In fact, remember that Habermas basically was a sociologist. He started his career as a sociologist, but now he moves on various directions. And nothing stops him from writing or reading. And he has been writing on various fields. So this is possible because of his concept of social solidarity. So interdisciplinary is meaningful In fact, social solidarity will not limit the interdisciplinary approach. In fact, it opens new avenues for social solidarity, social rationality, opens up new avenues for interdisciplinary research.
I think there are, sir, there are two significant insightful questions, one by Professor Kosi Thakran and one by Dr. Prashant Shukla. So, Professor Kosi, would you like to have interaction? Dr. Prashant Shukla?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
I have a doubt with reference to the previous question, which made a kind of, I believe, a sweeping generalization by saying that Habermas theory is more inclusive in nature, whereas Indian philosophy becomes exclusive in nature, and Indian philosophy promotes monologue. My emphasis is that this claim or this allegation of being exclusivistic theory is always posed against Habermas, because the kind of idealistic situation he's talking about is only possible in the French coffee house culture, not in a melting pot like that of India. So this allegation exactly goes against Habermas. Some of the times, of course, the responses are given. Second, Indian philosophy is hierarchical and monological. That is also problematic, because as we all know, Vedas were never considered philosophical in nature. The philosophy of India, particularly Vedanta, comes with the Upanishads, which were a reaction to the Buddhist interrogation. So goes between the Pradhan Mala, like the Buddha and the Vedanta and the Mimamsas and so on. So most of the times, Indian philosophy has always been dialogical and less hierarchical in nature. That's my perception about the thing. I would like to have the expert comments of Professor Pannisalvam. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, thank you. Now, with regard to this inclusivity and the exclusivity of Habermas and Indian approach. Now, with regard, I would take up on the Indian perspective. I don't know whether you got my point correctly. By saying that Indian philosophical approach is complete by itself, I mean that it is inclusive in its approach, in the sense that is, it is perfect within that framework. But, sometimes it is argued by many Indian scholars that the opponent failed to understand the position of my statement, and they create a situation, or they think that I am on the other side, and they give the wrong argument. So this is how the dialogue takes place sometimes. But the nuances of Indian philosophical tradition has to be approached properly, so that that Indian philosophy also has the methodology of Habermas, but at the same time, we have to understand, whether we like it or not, we have to accept the fact that the metaphysics has been a dominating, shall I use the word figure, dominating aspect in Indian philosophical tradition. And this is a major criticism against Indian philosophy by many, and I also joined them, because now when you start something with a metaphysical presupposition, then you have to talk about your own system within that framework. You can't go out. But as I said in the beginning itself, that each system is complete by itself. It is with regard to that particular system, it is perfect, no doubt. But the problem is the metaphysical approach, or the metaphysical baggage which we always carry. This, I think, is some problem, but I don't know. This is how I view. I forgot. Sorry, second one. Can you repeat it, or just take a clue? Second one, I forgot.
Yeah, even Habermas was sometimes blamed to be exclusivistic in nature, because his idealistic situation becomes feasible only in the French coffee house culture, not possible in the day-to-day society. Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I said no. My major criticism against him and Roderick and others also, they say that the problem is that he's aiming at something which he thinks can be achieved. But till now, we have not achieved that. So it has its own limitation, I would say. So in one way, we can say it is also an exclusivist approach. But at the same time, one can also, it is inclusive because in this aspect, that is, I would say that his approach is inclusive because he has transcended the limitation of language. That is how language, I think, I mean, this is not his phrase, language is imprisoned in Wittgenstein or in philosophy or language. Now language is free. That's why we move from language, philosophy language, to discourse. So I would say he's both an inclusivist and an exclusivist. You are right. But it is something which one has to work out, whether it is possible or not, I don't know. I have my own suspicion about this. But still, I feel that what all he has said, it is very difficult for us to apply in Indian context. This is my view. I may be wrong also. I don't know.
Thank you, Prashant.
Now, I don't mind accepting him.
Professor Kosi, there is a question from Professor Kosi Takran. Professor Kosi, are you listening? Hello, Kosi. Now we can go to Purvayan and Amita, maybe. Next one is Purvayan, Purvayan is there. Kosi, yeah. Kosi, please ask your question. He's asking, the question is Professor Pani Sarvam, sir. Professor Kosi has asked a question, and that is, the question is, let me read out. Can you kindly clarify whether Habermas treats system as disconnected from life world in the context of communicative action?
Is he available? I want to see him. He's not available.
His mic is not functioning. He has written that.
Okay. Hope you will listen to me. Koshi.
His mic is not working, sir. His mic is
okay. Professor Koshi, thank you for your wonderful question. Now, when we, there is a connection between between the system and life world. But what I was trying to say is that there is a interrelation between these two. But which one is needed or which one is important? That is a question. So in the life world, there is a space for other. There is a space for modification, remodification, and discourse on. But in system, it becomes very rigid. So that's why he opens up the possibility of the life world wherein the plurality of approaches can be acceptable. Okay.
So I suppose that all the questions are taken up. If anybody is willing to ask any question, most welcome to ask question.
May I, Professor Ponisilvam?
Yeah, sure. Please come foundation,
may I?
Please.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Professor Ponisilvam, sir, for such an illuminating lecture. I would like to just know from you about the dialogical understanding aspect of Habermas, because dialogical understanding is one of the very key features in Habermas' theory. Suppose if one way of communicating with others fail in order to arrive at a consensus, would he like to adopt another way of communication? What do you think on this? Was I audible, sir? You kindly thank you.
Let me try to answer this question, which is a little complicated. Now this dialogical approach, as far as I know, Habermas has not said anything with regard to this shifting of the paradigm or with regard to changing of a particular dialogical mode and then changing it to another. So in his approach, since everything is open, everything is clear, and everything is unproblematic, then there will not be any problem. Which means in this approach, in this dialogical dialogue, there is everything is open. So nothing is hidden. There is no place for any distorted communication. Since everything is open, one methodology would sufficiently. Because no, when will this particular method which I am adopting will end up in failure? If that method, if I have got some hidden agenda, if I don't understand you properly, then there is some problem between us. Then we'll think of some other, because I want to have a dialogue so with you. So I will change my methodology or you will change. But there is no space for this in Habermas, because now, since he's open, everything is open, nothing is hidden. So there is no problematic dialogue that will take place. That's why the very usage of the word symmetrical has a lot of implication. It is not a, we say that we assume that the word is so simple, but it is not. If you read it from his standpoint, you would say that how the symmetrical relation can give equality, can bring us together.
Okay. Wonderful, sir. It was the beauty of the presentation is that so many questions are taken up. And
Professor Pandey,
yeah.
May I ask a very quick question?
Anupam,
Yes.
Please.
Thank you, sir, for a very wonderful talk and an interesting too. Sir, when we examine Habermas's two realms, one the structural rigidity, that is the social rigidity. On the other hand, we talk about evolving life world. Can we insert Richard Rorty's idea of cultural politics to fill the gap between the two?
Yeah. This is a very important question. But I would say that I prefer the methodology of Habermas rather than Richard Rorty's cultural method, because I still feel that though there is a structural rigidity which is involved in the life world, there is also a space for openness. This openness can solve many of the problems. But one thing here I would like to say, when we say life world, it should be remembered that who has the capacity to alter or change? This is something which has to be properly analyzed. So I would say the structural rigidity which is implied in life world has got a lot of implication, and I prefer this methodology of Habermas rather than Rorty, which of course has some difficulty. I mean, for me, there is some problem in understanding that methodology, because now I feel that life world has got a lot of implications and it is wide open and everything is included. But I don't want to go further, because there is one problem which is involved in life world. That is, who has the right to make certain amendments or changes? The life world, though it is open, then it sometimes it is argued only who belong to the particular group can make certain changes in that. So there is a dialogue regarding that, but I have my limitation with regard to that. But with regard to Rorty, because Rorty talks about, for example, who are our conversational partners. This is one important concept which Rorty has been discussing. But here, there is no such issue that is involved. It is open. It is open to all. Everybody is part and parcel of a dialogue. So I prefer Habermas than Rorty.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. You have taken so many questions.
Thank you.
It was really wonderful to listen from you, direct answers from questions, and there are some points raised by Lalito. There are some points like in brief I would like to state, because otherwise Lalit is our neighbor in IIT Kanpur in philosophy. So it's very interesting to, I mean, sir, I take this little freedom because you belong to Wittgenstein society and you encourage us to ask questions like Daya Krishna. So so these three questions, short questions are, I mean, like, is the notion of social rationality teleological or goal-oriented for Habermas? If it is, then what it aspires to, number one. And then isn't Habermas's suggestions to the scientism already included in the new philosophy of science from developmental, evolutionary and social perspective? And the third is Carnapian quote-unquote rational reconstruction subsumed in Habermasian approach? So these are something like questions which are good for students. So I suppose that these will be last questions, and then I would like to invite Dr. Rajni. So after your comments, sir, brief comments, then I would like to invite Dr. Rajni Srivastava for formal vote of thanks.
Very briefly, I'll answer. So definitely, Habermasian method is goal-oriented, and he's aiming at the social solidarity through this ideal species. So definitely it has a goal, but the goal, when we are going to achieve this goal, perhaps we may not be in a position to reach this goal. So definitely he has an aim to reach this goal, but I'm a little skeptical about that. Now scientism, the scientism which the philosophy of, now especially feminist understanding of philosophy of science has this notion. In fact, tomorrow I'm going to deliver a lecture on feminist understanding of philosophy of science in Annamalai University. So he comes very close to the feminist understanding of philosophy of science. So that is a very beautiful dialogue which Habermas has developed with regard to the philosophers of science and the scientism which they have been suggesting to us. Then this Carnap's rational thing, this thing is very much available in Habermas, and I would say it is a development of a Carnapian method. Not only Carnapian method, and see, the uniqueness of Habermas is that since he has come through philosophy of language, he is well versed in the methodologies which are available to us, and then he goes further. That is his uniqueness. In fact, I would like to state that in one of the seminars, I talked about how Habermasian method has got some advantages over Wittgenstein's method. Professor Suresh Chandra, who was there, he said, No, you can't blame Wittgenstein for that. Had Wittgenstein been alive, he would have given some answers like Habermas. This is true. They have their own limitation in the sense that, the philosophy of language has been developing and they have given some methodology. But what is interesting is Habermas could imbibe all this method. He could take all this method inside his theory, and he has developed his theory. But as I said in my lecture, that this is not something very very much new, because he has taken some points from speech acts, and then Austin's, J.L. Austin's performatory, this thing. So all these are developed for that. So I accept that Carnap's methodology is very much implicit in this.
From North Bengal University to Mumbai, and then from Mumbai to Chennai, and then from Chennai to Madurai, and then from Madurai to IIT Kanpur, and then again your friend Dr. Bhaskar Bhattacharya. A single line question. Requesting.
Very grateful and thankful to you, sir, for listening a very wonderful lecture on Habermas.
Thank you.
Just a small query comes to my mind. That is that Mimamsaka has stated all communication action all communication are action oriented utterance, but Advaitic is in opposite way, said that if I not wrong, all language are not communicate uh, not action-oriented utterance. Sir, in this regard, thus I would like to ask you that regarding your book, that Sankara and Wittgenstein. So, sir, regarding Wittgenstein, in the first part, that is Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, he's very interesting statement that whereof one cannot speak, thereof one must be silent. In this regard, sir, his communication, his language, that silence. So is that are you referring when you writing this book that earlier Tractatian part or later part? Which part, sir, you are referring in making resemblance between Sankara and Wittgenstein? That is my small query, sir.
It is not a small query, big query, but no problem, Bhaskar. Now, with regards to the sentence, whereof one cannot speak, thereof one must be silent, there are two ways of understanding. Since we are all members of K.C. Pandey's Wittgenstein Society, we should know that there are two ways of understanding this statement. One is that my language stops at a particular place. Now, when I see a wall in front of me, it means two things. One is that beyond this wall, there is nothing. Okay. Then another thing is beyond this wall, there is something which I can't see. Okay. So there are two ways of understanding. Now, similarly, when Wittgenstein speaks about the silence, they say one can interpret it by saying, as because language cannot convey something which it cannot convey, we have to stop. Then other thing is my language has its limitation. Then it doesn't mean that there is nothing outside that. Now, these two ways of understanding Wittgenstein is very much acceptable. Now, for example, I would accept the second way. That is, Wittgenstein would say, according to me, Wittgenstein is talking about the limitation of language, but it doesn't mean that beyond language there is nothing. There is something, or the only thing is my language is not competent to explain that. In fact, this is a view of many thinkers like Suresh Chandra, and in Western tradition, we can talk about K.T. Fawn and others. But if you ask Professor Rajendra Prasad, he will not accept that. He would say, no, that's all. When you can't say something about beyond language, then that's all. Don't say anything beyond that. So he has got one standpoint. So there are two ways of understanding. Stenis also has got this approach. So there are two ways of understanding. Both, I would say, is acceptable. Especially for Indian mind, to use Suresh Chandra's phrase, Indian Wittgensteinian. For us, that Wittgenstein allows that language has something beyond our conception, which means there is something beyond language which I cannot understand. So it doesn't mean that what exists on the other side or what exists beyond my language is nonsensical. No, this might be.
So it was wonderful, and I suppose that we learn from asking questions more. Somebody asks questions, then everybody learns something, that something is the state of affair. In so many areas which are less understood. So this has been a great opportunity for all of us to understand some. Definitely, I think most of us, I would feel that we had some insights to gain from today's lecture, that we are taking something from here, from these talks, this talk by Professor Paneerselvam, that everybody has some points to learn. And this philosophy department of Lucknow University is organizing these Saturday seminars, and I request that everybody to get connected on Saturdays as per their availability. And we are going to have it regular kind of thing. And with this, I would like to invite Dr. Rajni Srivastava, Department of Philosophy, Lucknow University, to present a formal vote of thanks. Dr. Rajni Srivastava, madam.
Okay. Thank you, Professor K.C. Pandey, for inviting me for a formal vote of thanks. Sir, it's my privilege and my pleasure to listen to Professor S. Paneerselvam. Am I audible?
Could you please open your video, ma'am?
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Yeah.
You are audible.
So it's my privilege and my pleasure to listen to Professor S. Paneerselvam. I'm grateful to you, sir, for your very informative, very illuminative and wonderful talk on the theory of communicative action in the Politics of Indian Philosophy. So you have made a wonderful exposition of Habermas' theory of communicative action and philosophy of language in Indian philosophy, that how social understanding is possible and it is only through dialogue. And in Indian philosophy too, we have the concept of aptavachan in our philosophy of language, especially developed by Advaitins, Mimamsakas and Nyayikas. We may find the parallels of communicative action. Once again, I'm thankful to you, sir. We all are benefited from your talk. I wish to thank Professor D.N. Yadav for joining this talk. I'm thankful to Professor Murli for participation. I'm also thankful to Professor K.C. Pandey, Head Department of Philosophy, for organizing the Saturday seminar and organizing this wonderful lecture on the communicative action. I'm thankful to Dr. Prashant Shukla also, as he summarized the whole talk in Hindi, that has benefited to all our students. I'm thankful to all the participants. I'm seeing Professor Koshi Tharakkan, Professor Bhaskar. I'm thankful to all the participants. And on the behalf of Department of Philosophy, I'm thankful to all, sir. Thank you.
So that's, can I say something? Yeah. Can I say one word?
Yeah, yes.
I am grateful to Professor K.C. Pandey for arranging this lecture. In fact, I have been very much benefited by this lecture, because by talking on Habermas, I get inspiration. And I admire him a lot. So it is always a pleasure to talk about Habermas, whom I had a very close contact in 2000. And K.C. Pandey for making this arrangement. In fact, by lecturing you learn, by teaching you learn. So this lecture gave me a lot of experience, in the sense that I learned a lot. And the wonderful questions which I received would make me to think further in this direction. So I thank you for this wonderful opportunity. Especially I thank senior professors like Professor Yadav, Professor Murli, Professor Koshi Tharakkan, and Bhattacharya, Bhaskar Bhattacharya, and then Prashant, Alok, many others, and students. In fact, my lecture is meant for students and research scholars. I felt that they should read Habermas in Indian context. And so I made an humble attempt. How far I was successful, I don't know. But in my attempt, I tried to show certain parallels. And I thank you very much for your patient listening for more than 1.5 hours.
It was great, sir, to listen to you.
Thank you.
Many questions I could not take up, like Dr. Pitambar Das' question. And excuse me that my intention was to take all the questions, but I could not take due to shortage of time. Maybe next Saturday, you can ask more questions different presenter. And Dr. Alok Chandan, Anurima, and Amita, everybody have been so kind to be here. So I'm grateful to everybody, Purbayan, and Bhaskar, Bharat, so many people whose name I couldn't take earlier. But now, basically, even now, I'm missing so many names apart from my students and scholars and very close friends who are here. So thank you all, everybody. And let us be together to put philosophy reflection in this Indian context in a better manner, in more vibrant philosophical reflections. This is the task that we have taken in Department of Philosophy, University of Lucknow. So from here on, we are not going to stop and keep on having much more active philosophical activities. So all would be invited and to present and to reflect and to interact. So thank you. With these words, thank you very much for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Pandey. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.